All right, so yesterday we started looking at the issue of how do we estimate propagation delays in the case of a more complex network where there are multiple resistive and capacitive elements, right? So in particular, when you have some kind of wire network which branches off, goes to multiple gates as input connections and so on, under those circumstances, what influence does that have on the delay through the wire? Okay, it's not just the case of wires alone, although wires are an important part as far as this complex networks are concerned. Similar kind of considerations also arise in the case of more complex logic gates themselves. Okay, so for now we are just going to look at it as an abstract problem on its own and see how it can be solved, or at least how we can get a handle on it. Okay, so to sort of motivate the final formula, what I'm going to end up doing is just present you with a formula saying this is how you estimate the delay, right? But let's sort of try and get a justification for it first. So to do that, we are going to start by looking at a very simple RC circuit, the simplest possible, which is just you have one resistance, one capacitance, right? This is V in, this is V out. Okay. So what is the relationship between Vn and Vout? So Vout is going to be some Vn and some exponential relation, right? Depending on initial conditions and so on. But if we leave aside all the initial conditions and in fact don't move out of the time domain, we can move into the Laplace domain, and this is how we would normally sort of indicate the equation for something like this, right? So what we would end up with is essentially equating currents VO by 1 over SC, that is the current flowing through this, must be equal to the current flowing in here, right? I1 is going to be given by VI divided by the total impedance, which is R plus 1 over SC. Okay, I2 equal to I1. So simplify, and what we end up with is going to be an equation like this. VO is equal to VO by VI is 1 over 1 plus SCR. Okay, so this is fairly straightforward to derive, right? The impedance through the capacitance is 1 over SC. The impedance through the resistance is just R itself. I'm equating the currents. The current due to VI must be equal to the current due to VO in the capacitance. Okay, you equate those and you get a relationship between VO and VI. This is the relationship. Now in this particular term over here, this RC, right, is called the time constant. Or alternatively, another thing is the first moment. Essentially what is happening is it is the coefficient of the first power of s in the equation. Therefore it sort of dominates what the time dependent performance is going to be like. Okay, this is a simple first order circuit, therefore there is only one 1 over 1 plus s something term. Okay, if we had a more complex circuit, you might end up with s square, s cube terms and so on. And our main goal is to understand what happens in such a situation. How do we deal with it when the circuit is more complex? Okay. So to understand that, let's look at the next more complex version of this circuit, which is going to look something like this. So far same. I add one more branch. So I'll call this R1, R2, C1. And C2. Okay. Once again, this is the input VI. Voltage here is VO, the output. I'll call this node or the potential here VX. Okay. I don't really need to know VX. It's just that it makes it a bit easier for me to compute the overall current balance. Okay. So, if I want to find what's my goal? I want to find VO in terms of VI. I want to find out what's the time relationship between the two. And from that, can I estimate something which tells me roughly how much time it will take after a step change at VI for a certain amount of change to occur at VO, right? So for example, from this previous graph, what we have found is the time constant is RC. Therefore, based on our discussion yesterday, what we can say is that if there is a step input at VI, then the amount of time that it will take for the output at VO to reach 50% of its final value is going to be 0.7 times RC. Okay? So, for now, what I am going to do is in fact just ignore the 0.7 term. Right? It doesn't really matter so much to us. What I want to know is, what is the main factor that dominates this delay? Okay, so the RC itself gives me an estimate of how much time it is going to take to go from 0 up to some percentage of the final output value. Okay, that's all that I really care about. At least this way I can compare two equivalent circuits. I have an RC on one of them, I have another R prime, C prime somewhere else. Using this kind of just the RC time constants, I can compare which one is going to be slower. Okay, so that 0.7 term remains constant. I'm going to ignore it from now onwards. Okay. So what happens in this second order circuit? Right. Once again, I can write down all the equations. What I would suggest is I'm going to sort of just jump a few steps over here and write down the final result. But please go ahead and do work this through. It sort of helps to understand it a bit better. Right. What we have over here is there is a certain current which is going to flow over here. I'll call this I1. There is another current here which is I2, and a third current here which is I3. Okay. So the current balance equation essentially that we are trying to solve over here is I3 is equal to I1 plus I2. Right? Kirchhoff's current law at node Vx. Node X rather. Okay. So, how do I write down these three currents? I can essentially use this in order to solve this entire problem. What I will end up with is I3 is equal to VI minus VX divided by R1. Okay. I2 is equal to what? How do I estimate the value of I2? SC1 into Vx, or Vx divided by 1 over SC1, right? Okay, I1 VO by 1 over SC2. Incidentally, there is one more equation over here, which is that this I1 can also be written as Vx divided by R2 plus 1 over SC2, right? Same thing, once again potential at X divided by the total impedance over there, because after all, whatever current flows through R2 is also the current flowing through C2, okay? So, this essentially, sorry, can you hear me at the back? So now what I'm going to see if you can get another battery. So without going through all the steps of how we simplify this, what I'm going to end up doing is straight away sort of, you know, give you what the final result looks like, right? What we need to do is eliminate Vx from this, from these equations, and write VO by VI, okay, in terms of R1, R2, C1, C2, okay? So if you go through this, what you will end up with is something which looks like this. VO by VI is going to end up being 1 over 1 plus S into C2 R2 plus C1 R1 plus C2 R1, okay, plus a square times something, some complex expression out there. Okay. Now what I am going to say over here is, as far as the behavior of this circuit is concerned, so what am I interested in? I am essentially going to apply a step input at Vi and I want to see how the output at Vo changes. Okay. And my claim over here is that the primary amount of the delay is going to be determined largely by this term, and the S square term is going to change the shape of the final output curve at Vo, but it will not change the delay or the actual, you know, the time to reach 50% or 60% or whatever it is by too much. It will change it, but the effect will be less than the effect of the first term, the coefficient of S. Okay. So in other words, what I am going to say is, as far as the first order estimate of the delay is concerned, this term over here, the coefficient of S, can be used as my time constant. Okay. Right. Similarly, I can do this for any circuit, any arbitrarily complex circuit, many resistances and capacitances. I can essentially solve the entire thing from Vi to Vo, okay, and find out what is that first order term, the coefficient of S, okay, and that gives me an estimate of what is the delay through this circuit, right. So now, for this particular circuit, that was doable. I could actually manage it by doing some computations over here. For more complex circuits in general, solving the entire equation is going to be very hard. Okay. So then there is something which is called Elmore's delay formula. Which was originally discovered obviously by someone called Elmore. Okay. This is a fairly old formula. It was discovered in 1959 or so, or at least the paper talking about it was published in 59. Right. So the formula itself is very well known. It has nothing to do with digital circuits or IC design. Right. It's just a general idea in the context of the time constants of RC networks. Right. So what does the formula say? It essentially says, I'll start off by giving this particular example. Over here, I will rewrite that formula as C1 into R1 plus C2 into R1 plus R2. Okay. Go back, look at this circuit, and I'll try to explain it in the context of what Elmore's formula finally says. Right? We have all these capacitances in the circuit. In this case, there are two capacitances, C1 and C2. So there are C1 and C2. What I want to find out is what to multiply them by. What are the corresponding resistances that we need to multiply them by in order to get the final time constant. Okay. What I am interested in is, my origin is Vi, where I am applying my pulse change or my step change, and my final destination is Vo. That's where I want to calculate the delay. Okay. So I will go along a path. Hopefully there is only one path through the circuit which leads from Vi to Vo. Right? What is a path? It's essentially a series of links, branches in the circuit through which I can essentially go in order to reach the final destination. At each of those points of intersection, those branches, branch points, there is a capacitance going to ground. Okay? There is also a shared resistance of whatever I have from the source until that particular point, that branch point. Okay. I will multiply that capacitance by that resistance which is there up to that branch point. Okay. So in this case, when I reach C1, how much is the resistance from Vi up to that? It's only R1. But when I reach C2, the total resistance on that path is R1 plus R2. Okay? So I write it as C1 into R1 plus C2 into R1 plus R2. And this I claim as my time constant. It is an estimate of the delay that will be incurred when I go from the input to that output, VO, because of these R and C elements. Okay? So keep in mind, this is an approximation. Why is it an approximation? Because depending on the relative values of R and C, you may find that that second order term is also significant. We have neglected it completely. But it could be a situation such that the second order term can make enough of a difference to the final result that, you know, you are off by 10%, 20%, more than that even. Okay? But to a first order of approximation, this gives you a good estimate of how much is the delay you are likely to see from the input to the output. Yeah. Exactly. So that's the next point, right? Remember what I said. I'm assuming you have a single path and that there are capacitors going to ground. So now, before we apply Elmore's formula, we now need to understand under what conditions it can be applied. Okay? So what are those conditions? The first thing we are going to assume is that we have a so-called pre-structured network. Right? For those of you who may have done a course in algorithms and data structures, what's a tree? It essentially has a single root point. It then has branches going out from there, eventually ending in leaves, right? So for example, something like this. You start here, you have branches, you have further branches, right? And all of these points are called leaves. They are the ends of the tree, right? So you have a root, you have branches, and you have leaves. Okay? So this is the definition of a tree. What that also means is, once you have a branch, there cannot be another merge. You cannot have two branches coming together and meeting at a point. Branches meet only when you are moving towards the root, from the leaves towards the root. Okay? You cannot have two things that branch off from each other and then come back and join again. That is just the definition of a tree, right? There's nothing fundamentally preventing you from doing, from creating a circuit like that. What we are saying is, if you have such a circuit, the formula will not apply. Okay? So the first condition is, the circuit structure that you are looking at must be a tree structure. Okay? Of course, with respect to, you know, where your input is and where your final output is going to be. Right? On every branch, you have a resistance. Right? And only a resistance. No other type of element is permitted over there. Or at least whatever you put over there has to be modeled as a resistance for the purpose of this formula. Right? As we will see later, in some cases, the branch elements could themselves be transistors. But then what we will do is, we will replace it by the equivalent resistance of the transistor in order to use this formula. Okay? The next thing is, at every branch point, also sometimes called a node, there is a capacitance to ground. Okay? So at each of these nodes in the circuit, there is a capacitance leading to ground. Okay? And finally, what we are going to assume is that there is a single input, which is of course the root of the tree, and we are interested in a single destination. Or a single target. Now what happens if I change the target and say I want to find the delay to some other point? That's fine, you can do that. You'll just have to rework the formula for that particular point, because the formula depends on where you are going. Okay? Now the formula itself is given by, the time constant is going to be given by summation over all the capacitances in the circuit, right? R I'm going to mark it as RS to I. Okay? So what is RS to I? Right? It is the total resistance on the path leading from the source up to that capacitance, but with one slight change. It's not all the way up to that capacitance. I am interested in one particular path from one input to a given output. Some of the capacitances will be directly on the path, some capacitances will be off that path. They will have their own resistances and so on going off the path. I am only interested in the shared resistance between these two paths. Okay? So it's a shared resistance up to the branch of I. Okay, let's take an example to understand what that means. Supposing I have a circuit which looks like this. This is R1, this is C1, R2, C2. Okay, R3, C3, R4, C4. Okay, take this point as Vi, the starting point. Okay, if I consider this as Vo, right, so I'm interested in the delay from Vi to Vo. Okay, what I'm saying is, because there are all these other capacitances in this, on this net effectively, right, which are being driven from this source Vi, I need to take their effect also into account. I cannot ignore them. Okay? So what that means is, as far as C1 is concerned, the shared resistance is going to be given by R1. Okay? Why is that? Because the total path that I am interested in is this, from Vi to Vo. It's a tree, therefore there is only one path, right? That's part of the definition of a tree. There is a unique path from the root to any leaf. Okay, no loops. So there is a unique path leading from Vi to Vo. The total resistance on that path is R1 plus R2. But if I'm looking at C1, then that shared resistance, the part that is common, is only R1. Okay? What about C2? What is the shared resistance? It's the same as the full resistance on the path, because C2 after all is my destination. That's where I want to go. Okay? So as far as C2 is concerned, it is R1 plus R2. Now what about C3? What is the total resistance up to C3? It is going to be this path, right? So the total resistance is R1 plus R3, but the shared resistance, shared between what? Between the path from VL to VO and the path to C3. The shared resistance is only R1. This is the common segment. Okay? So as far as C3 is concerned, shared resistance is R1. As far as C4 is concerned, same story. The total path leading to C4 is R1, R3, R4. But R3 and R4 are off my required path. Okay? Therefore, R1 alone is the one that influences it. Okay? So all this is true for the case that VO at C2. Right? I am interested in taking the output at C2. Yeah. If you pull out the R2 resistor. Okay? Okay, so here, yeah. Okay, so the question is, what happens if instead of the joint over here, it was connected over here? Is that right? The other end of R4. No, if you take, 1 second. So if you are talking about, this is R1, C1, R2, C2, I have R3, C3 like this, R4 going where? R4 going here, this is a loop, it's not a tree, right? This is not allowed. So the formula doesn't apply here, that's all. You can build a circuit like this. Nothing is preventing you from building a circuit, but the formula doesn't apply. That's all. Okay? Alright, so right. So going back to this circuit, what does this mean? That the time constant over here is going to be given by R1 C1 plus R1 plus R2 into C2. Plus R1 C3 plus R1 C4. Okay? Intuitively, what is this telling you? Right? Think about it. It's finally saying that I applied a step at VI and looking at the output at VO. How much time is it going to take for that output at VO to rise to a certain value? Right? What are all the things which are going to affect that significantly? Okay? And as an estimate, what we are saying is, the rise at VI is going to inject some current into this circuit. That current is what is going to cause this voltage at VO to rise. Okay? The problem is some part of that current is going to go towards charging C1. Okay? So it is a diversion. The fact that C1 is there is actually diverting some of my current from C2 and preventing it from charging fast. If it diverts the current, less current is available at C2 for charging, therefore it will take more time. How much more time? The additional time is estimated as R1 C1. Yeah, so I'll get to that next. Okay. So R1 C1 is sort of the contribution due to the fact that C1 is present. As far as C3 is concerned, the total resistance up to it is actually R1 plus R3. But what we are saying is how much of the current gets diverted over there. And how much does it impact the delay? Only the part due to R1. Because my path that I am finally looking at is at C2. The fact that R3 is there somewhere else does not really influence the delay to C2. This is a very, very rough intuitive explanation. The only correct explanation is to understand the equations. Right? So if you are finding the intuition non-intuitive, forget about it. Just stick with the equation. Okay, but coming back to his question, What happens if we were interested instead at the delay at R4 or C4, right? So in other words, I'm interested in this point. I'll call this VO prime, right? So VI to VO prime, if I'm interested in this delay, right? Now what is the path of interest? It's going to be this VI to VO prime is going through R1, R3 and R4, okay? But I still need to find out the sort of common path segments and multiply by the corresponding R values in order to get the total delay. So what are the common R segments? For C1, it is R1, right? Because after R1, it branches away, right? So in other words, up to C1, from VI, there is only R1. There is no other extra thing that I can actually get. And it turns out both the branches come only after C1. So it is common to whichever path you are finally leading to. Okay? What about C2? Also R1. Because even though the total resistance to C2 is R1 plus R2, after it reaches R1, after it crosses R1, it branches off. My path of interest has branched off. Okay, so the common resistance is only R1. What about C3? R1 plus R3. Because both R1 and R3 are on the path which leads to my final destination. What about C4? The full path, R1 plus R3 plus R4. So what is the time constant? Summation of C multiplied by this resistance values, the shared resistance values. So C1 into R1 plus C2 into R1 plus C3 into R1 plus R3 plus C4 into R1 plus R3 plus R4. Yeah.
So we have to look at it from the different perspective. So if we take the path of interest,
yeah,
and take each resistance on the path,
yeah,
and multiply it by all the capacitors which are
downstream of it. Yes. That is another way of looking at it, right? So you could also say, I'm going to consider the path that I'm interested in, R1, R2, R3, R4, right? Or rather R1, R3, R4 in this case. Take each of those resistance segments, find out how much is the total capacitance downstream of that. What do I mean by downstream? What and all are the capacitance I can reach going further away from the source from this point? So in fact, you'll find that that is also another way in which the formula is sometimes stated, right? They mean the same thing effectively. Because it's a tree, right? So which way you apply it does not really matter. You should end up with the same result, okay? And both of these are giving you an estimate of how much is the delay. Now, why is this useful? You can see that straight away over here, right? One of the important things it's telling you is, from these equations, I can pretty much say for sure that the delay from VI to VO is going to be less than the delay from VI to VO prime. Partly because it's a longer path, R1 plus R3 plus R4, right? The contributions essentially of the resistances are more for the individual capacitances. Unless R2 turns out to be very large, in which case the delay on that C2 segment would be very large and that would dominate everything else, right? Otherwise, you would typically expect that the delay to R4 is going to be, or rather C4 is going to be greater than the delay to C2. But that is also important. If R2 turned out to be large, then that would dominate. And it's sort of pretty easy to just look at these, the tree structure, and straight away say what is it that would influence that. Yeah. What do you mean output between R3 and R4?
The V out
is over here. So this is a bit tricky because the thing is the formula itself normally talks about the leaves of the tree. That point between R3 and R4 is not a leaf, right? It has something further downstream of it as well, right? The formula would sort of apply. You can sort of ignore the R4 part of it because if you think about it intuitively, again, what is happening is the current has already reached C3 and it is sort of working to charge it. So you don't need to worry about what is further downstream of it. But that is an even further sort of weak approximation. It's not going to be very accurate at that point. But the formula is primarily meant for the leaves of the trees. And R3, R4 junction is not a leaf. Right? It will still give you an estimate. It won't be very, it won't even be as accurate as the other estimate, the leaves are. That's all. Okay? Alright. So, we will later get to a point where we will actually see what, you know, where this kind of formula applies in the context of logic circuits itself, right? But before that, I want to sort of just give a motivating example, one particular place where this needs to be applied, which will come up again later. You'll understand it better as we go further down, but you're already in a position where you can sort of get an idea of what's going on over here, right? There is one particular net in any digital circuit which is going to be very long and which basically covers pretty much the entire circuit, which has to go all over the place, which has to go to all parts of the circuit, no matter how big the circuit is. What do you think that is?
Supply.
Huh?
Supply.
Supply and ground, of course. So that's correct, right? So the supply and ground, as he said, need to reach all parts of the circuit. Thing about supply and ground is they are not switching. So you don't need to worry too much about them. You don't really have transitions on supply and ground. At least you definitely don't have full 0 to VDD transitions. That will happen only once at system startup. Okay? There is another similar
clock.
Net. Exactly. The clock. Okay? So any digital circuit which is built in a synchronous fashion. What do we mean by synchronous? We are assuming that you have some kind of flip-flops or register, something like which is edge-triggered typically. Right? And that you are going to supply a clock to all of those flip-flops. Okay? How do we make edge-triggered flip-flops? How do we sort of use them and so on? We'll get to that later. But you are already aware of what a flip-flop is. Right? It's a storage element. It's used in order to store a particular data until the clock arrives and allows it to change. So typically the way that a circuit is built is, I take one clock signal and supply it to all the flip-flops in the circuit. Now when you do it in the lab on a breadboard, that's easy. You take a square wave generator, just wire it over there, connect it to all the flip-flop clock inputs. But when you are building Intel's latest processor, right, with a few billion transistors, right, you now need to make sure that this clock can reach all the flip-flops. There won't be a billion flip-flops, but there will be several thousands. Okay, distributed all over the circuit. Not only that, the circuit itself, by the scale of integration, is pretty big, right? Because we are talking about features that are on the scale of sub-micron, right? 0.18 micron transistors. And compared to the 0.18 micron, the chip itself could be something like up to a couple of centimeters in size. Okay? It's like a thousand times the size. So effectively, a thousand times the length of a transistor. Okay? So you have this one clock wire which needs to go all across these different parts of the circuit and needs to reach all the flip-flops. Okay? So it is typically going to look something like this. There is a clock source over here, and that clock source will then have to branch out, okay, to reach different parts of the circuit. The different branches will have different lengths. Over here I might have some flip-flops. It needs to reach something over here, right? Something else goes off in another direction, okay? Some kind of a structure of this sort, right? The important part is, it's a tree. Because you do not have multiple clock sources trying to come and join at some point and drive the same flip-flop. You have one clock that you are trying to apply and you want it to reach everywhere. Okay? These segments can be modeled as wires. What is a wire? Like I said, every wire has some resistance associated with it, just like a normal wire, right? The resistance is proportional to the length of the wire, inversely proportional to the area of cross section, okay, which in this case will be the width of the wire. And the capacitance is also going to be proportional to typically to the length of the wire, because it's going to be proportional to the area under that wire segment. Okay, so you're going to end up with resistors and capacitors in a tree structure like this, and you want to find out how much is the delay that is incurred when you go from the source all the way to each of these flip flops. Why is that important? Because if I have different delays to the different flip flops, it means that they are actually latching data at different instants of time. There might be a few picoseconds apart, but that can be sufficient to throw things off when your entire time budget is in the order of a few hundred picoseconds. Right? So for example, a processor working at 3 gigahertz, the total time budget available to you is 300 picoseconds. If the clock is off by 10 or 20 picoseconds over here because of these delays, that can have a significant impact on whether or not you can even meet timing, or whether the timing analysis that you did actually holds true or not. Okay? Right. So that's one part of it which, so how do you build clock networks and so on is something which is interesting on its own, right? It's not a major area of research. People have a good handle on how to do it, right? But the point is, in order to analyze a circuit like this, you need to have some kind of an estimate. So the Elmore delay formula gives you a first order estimate of what can be used over there. In practice, because the clock is such an important circuit, part of the circuit, we use more complex analysis. You actually don't bother with first order analysis like Elmore. You might even do a more complex simulation in order to find out what are the true delays. Right? But something like this can still be used in order to estimate what's happening. Right? The second place where this becomes important is when we are considering long wires. Okay? So I'm going to assume that I have some kind of a long wire. Well, let me even leave out this capacitance. I don't even want to bother about what it's driving. Right? I'll assume it's driving some small load. Forget the load for now. Just assume it's negligible compared to the length of the wire itself. Right? Now, typically the way that the wire is constructed is by putting down some kind of metal on top of the silicon substrate, but not directly on the substrate, it's going to be over the field oxide. Okay, so you have the insulating field oxide, and then you have a metal which is laid out, and that acts as a wire. Okay, at one end of it you have the source, which would be a clock pin or a clock driver circuit or another signal, and at the other end you have whatever input it is connected to. So it could be the clock input of a flip-flop, or it could be directly some input of a NAND gate or an inverter or whatever it is, right? So we don't care about all of that. We don't care about the load, we don't care about the source, we are concerned about that wire itself. Okay, the important part about it is it will have a certain width and it has a certain length. The thickness is pretty much going to be determined by technology parameters. Okay, usually what happens is you have substrate, then you have an insulating layer. On top of that, you have the metal layers. Okay, they will have a certain height and they will have a certain width. Okay, both the height as well as the width of the metal layer are typically determined by the layer at which it is. Okay, what I mean by that is, this is usually what is called metal 1. The first layer of metal above the substrate. After that, you have more insulator, metal 2. Then you have still more insulator, metal 3. I'm intentionally drawing it as getting bigger and bigger as we go to higher metal layers. Okay? Because that's how it's usually done in practice. The smallest metal layers, or rather the lowest metal layers, the ones which are closest to the substrate, are used primarily for making connections between gates. Okay? So they need to be on the order of thickness and the order of length of transistors themselves, so that they can directly make contact with the transistors and be used in order to take a short signal from one logic gate to another which is nearby. Okay. So what is done in that case is you keep all of the metal pieces in that layer more or less the same width and height. It has to be the same height. The width also you pretty much keep it the same. Okay, and use it in order to connect all of these things. As you go to higher and higher metal layers, you increase the height of the metal and you increase the width of the metal. Why is that good? It reduces the resistivity. Or rather, it reduces the resistance per unit length. Not the resistivity. The resistivity remains a constant, but rho L by A, the by A becomes, the A becomes larger, therefore the rho by A becomes smaller. Okay, so the resistance per unit length in some sense sort of reduces, right? Until finally we can end up at the uppermost levels where we have really tall and wide wires. How tall, how wide, they could be several microns even, okay? But it depends on the process, of course. Maybe not several microns, but it could be definitely more than a micron, for example, even in a 0.18 micron process, right? The idea is that those wires are used in order to carry the signals which need to traverse a larger part of the circuit. How large is large? Anything which is several transistors, so maybe 10 or 20 transistors is large enough. If I need to go across that kind of length, I need to have a relatively large wire so that it can carry that current with minimum loss of voltage due to the drop across the wire. If I have a clock signal, it has to travel all across the circuit, so it has to be really low resistance as far as possible. Okay, so those would probably be at one of the higher metal layers. Okay, so the point is typically you have multiple layers of metal. 6 layers was common a few years ago. Now you typically have 10 or sometimes even more. Okay, it's like a PCB, it's like a printed circuit board, right? Printed circuit boards also nowadays you can have up to like 20-30 layers even. And typically what you do is you sort of have some kind of planning for what each layer of routing is going to carry. Some of them will carry VDD, that is the supply voltage, some will carry ground, some will carry clock signals, the others will carry just the local routing. Same kind of planning is done even at the circuit level. Okay. So the point about all this is that you can model resistance as some resistance per unit length multiplied by the length of the wire. Same way the total capacitance can also be multiplied as C times L, right? Where small c is a capacitance per unit length. Okay? Which means that now this long wire that you had, if I was to sit and measure its total resistance, its R would come out as R times L, total capacitance would come out as C times L. Right? And therefore, if you ask me what is the delay that I am going to get when I apply a VI over here and try to measure VO over here, first order estimate is going to be given by tau is equal to RC. Right? It turns out this is not a very good estimate. In fact, this is off by quite a large amount. A more accurate estimate is RC by 2. So this is off by pretty much 100%. Okay, it is double of what it should be. Why is that so? Because it's not just one wire with that resistance and that capacitance. It's actually a wire with many small segments, each of which has a certain resistance and capacitance of its own. Right? So how do you model such a circuit? How do you build something applied and how do you find its equivalent resistance and capacitance and time constant? You can apply the Elmore formula in order to do that. Okay? So I'll stop here for now. Just complete this in the next class.